Welcome to a new test and teardown video. This time it's something completely different. This is an ST-8000 HF modem from HAL Communications. I believe this one is from 1989. I found a few PDF flyers on the internet. And they talk about this one should be able to do frequency shift coding or on-off coding of data for wireless communication. So you can send data using different frequency shifting and all that kind of stuff. And it should be able to be set up for different baud rates and frequencies and shifts and all that kind of stuff. And there's a really cool CRT scope here where you can analyze the frequency shifts when you're transmitting and when you're receiving, as far as I imagine. We got some different setup for the different data and all that kind of stuff. And this one was stored for quite a lot of years. So I really think I should open it before I just power it up. I need to see what kind of state are we in here. So this is the rear. Of course, this one is from 1989. And then you'll see more and more of this nice IEC connector. So that means it should be super easy to power this up. Got a lot of undefined input and output. It says version 2, so that is important for the remote interface here. Scope, so you can set an external scope. Diversity, aha, interesting. We got two connectors here for input and output. See, this is transmitter, and that is, of course, audio input, output and stuff. And this one is receiver audio. I guess we can just put in some headphones here and listen to what is going on. And this is the model and number information. So now we're inside, and that is actually really, really nice. So the CRT unit is one really, really nice unit, clearly designed in a little bit different technology than the other two CPU cards. And that's a battery in this one, a clock and some data retention stuff, and that is definitely some SRAM. And we got some more. We got two, is that two processors, Z80 processors? So one is the CPU and one is the DOTS. Oh, look at that. And all the classic interface ICs, that many. That is a connector for the rear connector. That was exactly like this when I opened it. And we got a screw missing here and another screw missing there. So that means somebody was, oh, maybe this can do the flip-flip. Somebody was in here before me, so I guess we have some power supplies down here, and somebody was in here to look at the power supplies. So I think I better take out those two screws and have a little look before I power this up. So this is all the analog stuff. It's also on a big board. And this one is a different technology. This is a four-layer board, at least. It's definitely a multi-layer board. And it is clearly full of all sorts of analog stuff. And also, it contains the power supply. And that will probably be a powerful 5 volt, 3, 4, 5 amps linear supply. Got a little bit of relays, isolation, transformers and stuff like that is of course needed for ground loop prevention. But tons of analog. That is amazing to see that many ICs. It's mainly op amps and analog stuff like that. Very, very advanced hardware solution. Yeah, still looking a little bit on the CRT board as well, if I can find the deflection amplifiers and such, but this is probably all there is to it, those tiny little transistors you see here, because this is just running at super low kilohertz sweeps, so we don't need really big deflection transistors and all that kind of stuff. And it's also a tiny, tiny tube here, so. But really, really good implementation. It's looking super nice and clean. Oh, by the way, when I was taking out the top board, I realized, yes, this is metal. This metal is screwed into this metal, and there we got metal down here as well. So there's a hinge kind of way. It just don't work. So when this board is screwed in here, you can't really flip it, because I think it's touching up here and something like that, right? Oh, how do you like that? So that metal screw is touching two of those tracks. Is that a good design, or is that a stupid design? All those tracks could easily have been a little bit more to the right. I'm not impressed. Here we go. Nice encoder input. They assemble everything here in this, then it goes to the flat cables. I mean, there's not a lot of wires and a lot of annoying stuff. You could easily manufacture quite a lot of these real fast and real easy, because all this stuff that takes a lot of time and hassle, there is not a lot of that here. So let's see about powering up. And this will be the mains cable, and then, ooh, I better be a little bit more careful. Here is my earth connection, so that means I'm not gonna kill myself here. It powers up. Oh, it even says, oh, that is sexy. Look at that. It's, oh, and we got a beam. It is using 34 watts, and now the picture is gone in the CRT, but I saw a dot in the middle. What is it doing? I got absolutely no clue so far. Oh, here we go. The dot is back. This dot is also all the way out to the left here, and then it is in the middle. How do we control all this? Ball rate is 1200. Input, output. Oh, that was a little bit of a... So, mark, space. What is it doing? And what is, here we go. Here I can fine adjust the ball rate. Oh, look at that. That is sexy. So all I have to do now is figuring out how to give it some audio. And see, where's the picture? Hello? Come back. Here we go. Maybe there's a loose connection or something wrong with the... Yes, look at that. Maybe it just goes on and off, or there's like a CRT saver. So if I don't touch any buttons, the CRT goes off. Let me try again. Just crank one of the buttons. Yes. That is genius. That means the CRT is going to last for a very long time. So you need to touch something, at least. Let me see if that is... Yes, it repeats. What if I touch this one? Yes, it is like that. How cool is that? Genius design! So right now I'm trying to rig up audio inputs. But I got this really weird smell. So I was trying to hunt down and see what is going on in here. But I don't find anything weird. See, that's the CPU. The Silex CPU, and that is the Silex dot. So the chip size in here is a lot smaller and it's not getting warm. It's interesting what a thermal camera can reveal. But I also find the static RAM getting really warm. That is not what I would expect. And of course the power resistors down here. That is within the deflection and all that kind of stuff. That gets warm. So that is expected. So I can't really explain this weird smell I got. Now I've been playing around with this thing for a couple of hours and I realize the mains transformer runs really, really warm. I can't even touch the damn thing. So maybe that is something they knew about, because we got those holes here in the cabinet just over the mains transformer, not over anything else, because anything else runs actually quite cold. This is of course the high current supply, and that is not really warm. It's almost too cold, really. I've been trying all sorts of settings, and I've been trying to input audio on all the different connectors in the back, and there's just no luck whatsoever. And it seems like this memory stuff is actually working. I can poke around with different settings here, and I can also store. No, I cannot. Where's my 300 Baud setting? Where is that? So how do I re... Okay, so that is gone. So it takes a little bit of time to set this up. So it can cover almost any speed like that, 10 and all the way to 1200. And then you can set the mark and the space tone individually like that. So this is now the space tone, whatever you like that tone to be, and then the mark frequency, and then you can track, and then you can fine tune like that. When you got all your settings, you can store it into memory. See, I was recalling here and then now it's gone because I didn't store it. Yeah. So there's not a lot more I can do, really. That sucks. I had the idea I could play with this and give it all sorts of tones and stuff, but that is not going to happen. Haha, I was finally able to figure this out. So here we go. Look at this little scope here. So that is my input frequency. So if I change the... See what happens? This is the frequency. So the 2200, and I think I am in a, let's go for 2200 maybe, yes, exactly. See, this is the wanted frequency, and see now it is moving like that, right? So that is 2200, and that is also my input. So if I change my input like that, it is responding to this. How nice is that? I'm so sorry this is super dim, but I think it is supposed to be this dim, so it's not gonna trash the CRT. I think it actually works. How nice. What if I go, yes, of course, and then the filters, and then, oh, yes, exactly. So this is 1900, to, and then we go up. How fantastic. And here we are in the middle. And then there's a little dot down here that's moving as well. But I don't know, it's going darker and brighter, and maybe that is the kind of smell that I smell. It smells something like high voltage kind of stuff. So there's definitely something with the CRT. But if I touch something here, then it goes on again. But I also see the brightness change a little bit. I was, of course, able to figure out how to adjust the CRT. So now there is a beautiful picture on this unit, and all there is to say is thank you very much for watching this very, very short video, and please come again tomorrow.